to kick off this evening's event by introducing an incredible partner in the city of San Jose and welcome Mayor Sam Liccardo. Please.
Mayor Liccardo has let me know that he's having a little bit of technical difficulties, but he'll be on in just a moment.
Okay, thank you. So we'll, if you are all in agreement, we'll just move on to our next speaker and we'll come back to Mayor Liccardo as soon as the technical difficulties have been resolved. And so it is my honor and pleasure to welcome Supervisor Dave Cortese, an amazing partner and a friend of education, who is here this evening to also give us a welcome and to share some updates about an important investment and partnership that has been developed with the County Board of Supervisors. Welcome, Supervisor Cortese.
Well, thank you, Dr. Dwan, and thank you to all of you who are fighting the good fight and doing the good work, especially now in the middle of this pandemic. As a former school board member myself and being married to a current school board member, as well as being a county supervisor who is very involved on a board that's very involved with education, I just commend you all for the work that you're doing, you know, for the work the educational system is doing to try to adapt and make sure that kids are getting educated and that education is still rigorous in a time when distance learning is the norm and when a time when there is so much uncertainty that, you know, administrators can't even figure out their normal plans for opening in the fall or ever. And so, we want you to know, I want you to know that there's great empathy and more than empathy, sometimes it's important to have resources. And Dr. Dwan, thank you for your leadership. I know you've been complimenting others on their leadership, but to pull together a plan to close the digital divide, realizing that the city of San Jose has resources, I'm sure the mayor will be talking about that shortly, that the county could provide resources and the news is we actually did. It was confirmed at last Tuesday's Board of Supervisors meeting that the full $7.2 million appropriation, I hope it's 0.2, not 0.1, but whatever it is, Dr. Dwan, I know it's over $7 million to close the digital divide based on your numbers, based on your survey and your hard work in terms of identifying those households that didn't have or don't have access, meaning not even a Wi-Fi or hotspot connection, and those students that don't have the hardware, even something as simple as a tablet, to connect. That money should hopefully provide the rest of the gap in terms of closing that digital divide, and we're very proud to do it. And I want to thank my colleagues on the Board of Supervisors, Supervisor Chavez, who was paying attention to this issue very closely as president of our board, and made me aware of it. And really, sometimes that kind of teamwork allows somebody, the way we work with only five members, much like a school board, it just takes somebody to come forward with the initial paperwork to get something like this going. I was proud to be in that position. But, you know, I'm more proud of my entire board because the support was unanimous. And even in this time of facing huge deficits looming, we haven't even adopted our upcoming budget yet. We put it off until August. There was still a willingness under these circumstances to say this can no longer be viewed as optional or an elective kind of an investment by the county. This is mandatory. We just can't have a state, county, and local jurisdictions telling kids to get online and learn remotely and then not give them the ability to actually do that. It would perpetuate the kind of redlining that we've seen historically in this country, and this state and this county are no exceptions to that. And I think COVID has laid bare some of those real problems, not just with the digital divide, but of course in other ways as well. So thank you. And thank you for an opportunity to make some opening comments. Thank you for an opportunity to participate, to help people. And this is certainly a group of people that we all want to help right now.
Thank you so much. The partnership is incredible, and we could not do this work without the support of the Board of Supervisors. And I really appreciate your message around equity. Really at the heart of this, when we looked at the need and we could see the disproportionate impact of the digital divide in certain communities, and the fact that as a County Office of Education, along with the Board of Supervisors, we have some shared responsibility for some high need vulnerable families. And the partnership just made a lot of sense, and I'm just incredibly grateful that under your leadership and with the support of your colleagues, we were able to secure this investment. This investment will be used to fund the gap. It will cover devices, hotspots, connectivity, and some additional support to some of the most vulnerable families throughout Santa Clara County. So again, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'd like to now ask Mayor Liccardo to give us some welcoming remarks. And again, I'm so grateful to the City of San Jose, Mayor Liccardo, and the City Council members for their collaboration and support here. And it appears I'm getting an additional message that Mayor is unable to connect. We are eager to have him join us, so whenever he is able to, we will make time for him in this event. But I think it's important to call out the significant investment that the City of San Jose is making. You'll hear some of that tonight as a part of this webinar. But additionally, there are other investments and partnerships that we'll be announcing that also support connectivity and short and long-term solutions. Yes. So we'll go on to our next slide. I'm really, as I mentioned, grateful for these partnerships. To really solve a problem is big, and a problem that has lingered as long as the digital divide has. It does take deep investment and deep partnership. I want to thank all of the electeds who have joined us tonight. I believe that we have some school board members. I also want to thank the County Board of Education for their support of this important work. And of me and the leadership of our office in trying to address the digital divide for all students in Santa Clara County. Again, this work cannot be done alone. And so the superintendents in our districts, the leaders in our schools, the educators who have had to deal with the shift to distance learning literally overnight, and all of the families who've experienced a lot of disruption due to COVID-19. I'm incredibly grateful for the contributions, the patience, and this challenge that has been presented to us, a challenge that I know Silicon Valley is up to solving together. Tonight's agenda will be, as I mentioned, focused on the Eastside Union High School District Access Eastside Initiative, which is a community Wi-Fi solution. There are a number of solutions that are being considered and studied throughout our county to help cross the digital divide. But there was a lot of interest in the community about what Eastside has been doing and how the partnership with the City of San Jose made this work possible. This evening we'll be joined by Randy Phelps from Eastside Union High School District, and also from the city, Jill Bourne, our city librarian, and Rajani Nair, assistant to the city manager, to learn in detail about Access Eastside. Next slide. I wanted to give just a brief update about where we are with digital equity in Santa Clara County. Since we last met, there have been some changes. The first thing I think is important to note is that our mind is, and our thoughts around digital equity have been shifting. And I think initially there was a belief that access to the internet was a luxury. It was something that we could use or not use. And certainly during the pandemic, we have learned that access to the internet and inclusivity of access is not only necessary for schooling, it is how we live, it is how we work, it's how we get benefits, it's how we learn to stay healthy, keep updated with information and much more. When we started into this work, we challenged ourselves just to think about the urgent need of access and connectivity. And now I think we are reimagining our relationship with the internet and really believe it to be as essential as water or electricity. And in terms of equity, need to ensure that all of the children and families in Santa Clara County have equitable access to the internet. Some of our early solutions focused on how we can get hotspots and data and funding for the gap in both hotspots, data, and devices. We are also working on efforts to increase digital literacy and internet safety. In the spring, our urgent need was shifting over time. We had about 15,000 households that were unconnected, and that was just our minimum urgent need, identified based on a per household connectivity. When we went to distance learning, we thought it was going to be short term. We thought we may be back in our school buildings later in the spring, or certainly to close out the school year. Over the summer, we imagined that we would be starting this school year with in-person instruction, and we learned on July 17th that, in fact, our schools would need to begin the school year in distance learning as a school and a community and county that is on the monitoring list for the state. The new requirements for distance learning that are described in Education Code require daily live interaction and instruction that's on par with what would have been provided could we have been delivering that instruction in person. That's a whole different level of need in terms of internet connectivity, device, and hotspot capability. We've been carefully monitoring the hotspot and device needs. You'll see that the numbers have increased largely because we are now recognizing that it is absolutely essential that each child has their own device and is able to access the internet in order to do their schooling. And this is necessary to meet these new requirements. Next slide. We also want to continue to understand the problem and the need, as well as continue to raise awareness about the disproportionate impact of the lack of digital access in our community. This is important because the potential is that unsolved, we will be exacerbating learning gaps, increasing inequities, and that will likely be due to the lack of equipment that is required to stay connected. We've been collecting data and mapping that data so we can understand where the greatest needs are and trying to drive our investments through a coordinated effort to solve this problem for all children and families. Next slide. The idea here has led us to establishing a priority schedule. And what the priority schedule is really focused on is also infrastructure, helping us understand that the resources, including funds, are limited, and that we may not be able to address 100% of the need that exists immediately. And we need to solve this problem priorities at a time. This will allow us to make equitable decisions regarding the allocation of resources. And our office is currently engaged with our city partners and the Emergency Operations Center's digital inclusion team to learn more about how this index can be scaled up to establish high need areas countywide and also inform our infrastructure buildouts. I also wanted to provide an update in terms of investments that have been made by local school districts to also solve this problem of digital equity. As we mentioned earlier, it can only be done through partnership, and the significant investments that have been made by the city, by the Board of Supervisors, are also being matched by local investments that school districts are making. And so school districts, since March alone, have spent over $13 million to invest in distance learning. And as we continue to plow through all the different aspects of these additional fund needs, we estimate that funds could range in this amount of $26.4 to $27.2 million. Please don't panic, Supervisor Cortese. We have not yet adjusted for the Board of Supervisors investment here. So I do recognize that our mayor has been able to join us, and so I'd like to turn the program over to Mayor Liccardo for a welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Duan. I appreciate it, and my apologies for the belated joining the meeting. I know you're well along here, so I don't want to interrupt the important progress you're making. I just want to really offer my very big thanks to you and to the entire coalition that's working so hard to make this happen. In the city of San Jose, we've really benefited from partnerships all around, and I think the lesson we've learned is that it takes a lot of different partners on a lot of different strategies. And we launched an effort 4 years ago, I guess, to see how we could tackle the digital divide. And we're only really seeing tremendous traction in the last year or so through a combination of efforts, I think three that I would just like to identify briefly. One is the great partnership with Eastside Union High School District, Randy Phelps and Chris Funk, and their visionary effort to launch an e-bond, which enabled 6,000 families to get connected around James Lick. And I think in a couple of weeks will be announced thousands more around Overfelt, four more schools on the way. So we look forward to that continue to bear fruit. Secondly, great partnership with AT&T and several of the, some of the providers, the telecom providers, through a combination of negotiated deals, Dolan Beckel and our team, Kip Harkness and others, that cut deals first to get a lot of small cells deployed, which we think will be a great backbone for future development. And then now 11,000 hotspots, which we expect will be deployed in August. I think we've had 2,500 already delivered, and we look forward to getting all those delivered to all the kids who need them and the 14 districts that have responded and identified those children that need the connection. And then finally, obviously through philanthropy, we're gonna need a lot more. And so really grateful to Eric Yuan, CEO of Zoom, and folks at Micron, IBM, and others who continue to contribute, and we're going to keep hitting them and others up for more help, because I think Marianne put it very well, we've got a big hole to fill. We've got a lot more work to do. So I look forward to working with all of you collectively to make great things happen. Thank you again, Dr. Duan.
Thank you so much for all the partnership and the trust in our office. You know, we really believe that these things cannot be done well alone. And I think we've been able to demonstrate through shared leadership that things get done when we do it together. So thank you so much. Next slide. At our last forum, there was a lot of interest in the various infrastructure needs and solutions. Mayor mentioned some of the 5G build out and some of the other things that are in the works as well. But tonight is going to be focused on community Wi-Fi. To begin, we'd like to engage with all of you on a polling question. The polling question, our first one this evening, is which barrier to access, inclusion, and equity is of most concern to you or your community? The cost of internet service, the lack of devices, connectivity to the internet, or technical assistance and guidance for parents? So we'll launch that poll. As we wrap up this poll, it looks like the area of most concern to tonight's attendees is connectivity to the internet. I think that we have seen progress in the lack of devices in terms of investments that were made. So I'm really encouraged to see that that's also reflected in the responses to the polls. We do now have time for a few questions, and so we'll check in to see if there are any in the Q&A for this first section.
Dr. Dewan, it doesn't look like we have any current questions at the moment.
Okay, terrific. Thank you. So it gives me pleasure then to transition to our friends and partners at Eastside Union High School District. Joining us this evening is the Chief Technology Officer, Randy Phelps. Welcome, Randy.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate being with such great company and with great partners, the mayor and his team, Jill and Rajani and the gang there, and Dolan, who's not here tonight, but I just want to give a shout out to Dolan Beckel. He's an absolutely fantastic partner. The great people at SmartWave, and from our district, our board has been fantastic in supporting this effort and other efforts to bridge the digital divide and provide for young people the resources they need in order to be successful. Next slide. So to start this, and I'll try to be as brief as I possibly can. 8 years ago, when Chris Funk and I came to Eastside at about the same time, and I knew that his major initiative and the board's initiative was equity and fairness and giving all the kids a shot and making sure that there was a level playing field. One of the things that we saw was that in the funding for schools, there was a problem in terms of how most schools do technology initiatives. They typically use regular municipal bonds that are 30 years in length. The problem with a 30-year bond is that most technology devices last between 4 and 8 years. And so you buy something with bond money, it lasts 4 to 8 years, but you pay for it for 30, which is just not a good value. So we wanted something different, and we were able to connect with a gentleman named Dale Scott. And Dale Scott helped us devise an ed tech bond, which is a special vehicle for schools to be able to use technology. Next slide. So in conventional bond structure, like I said, the taxpayer, it's for giant buildings, and it's for things that last for 40 or 50 years. It's for very, very large capital projects, where a Chromebook or even a wireless network is not something like that. And so it's not a great fit, but unfortunately the finances for schools only provide for that. So we wanted something different. And so go ahead, next slide. In our original issuance plan, how ours works is that we draw down as soon as our previous drawdown pays off. So we were never in arrears. And what's great about that is that we have the maximum amount available to us. In a typical municipal bond, most of the time, the school district or the entity going after the bond has a difficult time sometimes selling all the bonds. So if you do a $100 million bond, you promise to the taxpayers $100 million worth of value. Unfortunately, you almost never reach that. So from the get-go, you can't fulfill on everything you wanted to do, not to mention things like inflation and things like that. For us, what's great is our bonds sell out between 4 and 6 hours when we issue them, because they're near-term bonds, and it just makes a lot of fiscal sense for both the people who are interested in that type of vehicle and for the district. So you can see in the graph, you can see each of our drawdowns. And so a lot of times when you buy technology with bond money, you get one-time funds one time. And so whatever initiative you do lives as long as that bond lasts. And then you have to scramble to try to find grants or money to support it. With ours, we knew that we were gonna have this over many, many years. And we were gonna be able to supply to our students and to our faculty a continuous influx of technology, and they knew that it was here to stay. Next slide. Now, we had to make a change. COVID made us draw down a little bit more this time because we wanted to fill the hole. And so for us, we actually had the flexibility to do so. What was also great was, since we were thinking about community wireless back 7 years ago when we first started working on it, and we already had the blueprint and the first school in James Lick, and Orfeld, I'm pleased to tell the mayor, is fully up. As of this week, we were driving around the neighborhood and we were getting 16 megabits everywhere we drove where there were families that lived in our neighborhood. So pretty good access. So we were ready when COVID came. We already had one school in, we'd already been successful with our Sprint grant, so we were able to give out 3,000 access points prior to COVID happening. What I mean by that is a data brick. So, you know, we had quite a bit of coverage already, and we had enough Chromebooks to go around for all of our students to issue them as a full one-to-one when we went out in March. We're just continuing that for the fall, and so all of our students will have a Chromebook for the fall. On top of that, we added another 1,000 Databricks, and so even in our, for our communities, we've been able to pretty much meet their needs. We know we'll have more, but as we build out the rest of the schools, we see that shrinking over time. And more importantly, this solution that we're putting in during COVID is a solution that will last and last and last and last. All we'll have to do once the infrastructure's in is put new radios in every 7 or 8 years. Next slide. How we use our tech bond. So Access Eastside is a very big part of it. And again, our board has been very forward thinking in this. They got the vision for this and they've driven it, and it's been awesome. We buy devices, Chromebooks, laptops. Wi-Fi on our campuses is border to border, and we've opened that up quite a bit for the community. The other key to our project is that it's not just for our students, it's for our community. There's two SSIDs. So, you know, when you log into wireless and you see your home network, but one of your kids may have it too, and they have their own network, or you see the neighborhood networks in place. For us, we have the San Jose City Wireless, and we have ESUHSD. Our students log into ESUHSD, and they use their credentials that they use at school, and so it's seamless for them, and they have access to all their apps and all the things they normally do. All that was bought with our tech bond. Our network upgrades, we have a fantastic network, software, training. Right now we're working really, really hard. In fact, after this, I've got another meeting to talk about the software solutions that we're providing for our special computer programming classes and video and things like that. We've put money toward training, safety and security with our cameras, our internet connection. We have 10 gig connections at every single site, radios, special devices for learning, and so on. You can kind of see the slide. So our tech bond has been a huge shot in the arm for the district in terms of moving things forward and being ready for this when it came. Next slide. So our assessment of Access Eastside, it was great when we sat down with all the partners. We started off with, well, how did we feel? And we said, we're extremely satisfied. The cooperation and help, and, you know, it's a tough vision to see this. A lot of cities don't think that Wi-Fi is something like water and power and safety. To us, it absolutely is. And we know the difference for our kids is the kids who have access do better than the kids who don't have access. So we've got to give them access. Public usage, you can kind of see the stats. We do a tremendous amount of data every month. And since we've gone out on SIP, our kids have used the daylights out of it. But what's even better is our community really has too. And hopefully they're out there learning new things, figuring out like what, how to fix their fence, how to get a job, all those important things that have to be done for families that are staying home. Technical performance, it's worked really, really well. Is it as good as a $200 connection at your home? No. It's not. But what it is it's a really, really great fountain that you can go fill up your container, you know, to use the analogy of water. You need some water. It's an absolutely great source for someone being able to go out in their front yard or sit in their backyard or most cases in their house and be able to get enough access to do their homework. Our expectation is not that this is perfect, but if it reaches about 75 to 78% of our households, it will be a tremendous investment. The way I reach that metric is most of the vendors right now are letting bricks for $10 a month. You get the brick either for free or you buy it for $25 or $50, whatever you pay, and then you pay $10 a month for access. Even if the device was free, that'd be about $120 a year. For us, we have 23,000 students. If we just tried to get half of our kids into that, it's $1.2 million a year. Well, and if we go for an actual half, it's about $1.34 million a year. That would be one school's installation for community wireless, which would last for 8 years. So to us, once we get this in, we'll have this for a very, very, very long time. And our community will benefit, our students will benefit, and the access is much better than what you'd get, than the reliability and setup for a brick. It's much better than that. Our educational benchmarks, we're, you know, poring over our scores and those kinds of things for the kids who are at James Lick. But James Lick is one of the rare schools that has actually raised their scores every single year, I think for the last 17 years. So pretty fantastic. Next slide. And so there's a poll.
Yes, so we're to our next polling question. And as we'll do the poll, we'll also take questions in the Q&A for this section if there are questions for Randy. But our poll is there a significant benefit after hearing Randy's presentation to providing free community wireless for non-students? And the possible responses are definitely yes, somewhat yes, definitely no, and unsure. You can see this is trending towards a definitely yes, and likely in recognition the important role that public schools play in the community, not just for students, but as a community hub as well.
What's amazing is doing this together with the city, working all of us closely, and the utilities have done a great job. Working together, it becomes affordable, doable, and like I said, it doesn't supplant the vendors that are selling goods and services. It just helps the people who don't have anything else.
So I think most of our participants have responded, so we can close the poll. 88% responded definitely yes, and you know, a few that did indicate unsure, no, or somewhat yes. But this was really helpful. So I don't see any questions in the Q&A. So Randy, I think you're getting off easy so far this evening. So it's my great pleasure now to transition to the City of San Jose Tech Bond Partnership, which is what really Randy was referring to, helped elevate this project and get it going. Jill Bourne, our city librarian, and Rajani Nair, assistant to the city manager, will provide this section of the presentation. Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Dewan and Randy. I'm so pleased to be here to talk about the partnership that developed between the city and Eastside Union to build out the first attendance area at James Lick, which was really a precursor to a much broader collaboration that allowed us also to pilot and test the development and implementation of community Wi-Fi for both students and all households in a high school attendance area. So as you've heard tonight, the full build out of Access Eastside was actually part of a broader digital inclusion plan that our city council voted unanimously to invest in. This project and others reflect the city's longstanding recognition of the importance of prioritizing and investing in digital inclusion. The library has been a key part of the City of San Jose's digital inclusion work since the initial broadband study in 2016. And my team and I have been tasked with leading the city's emergency operations work in the area of digital inclusion. So we know that access to digital connectivity has become an essential service for residents. And we are proud to lead SJ Access, which is the city's new initiative to provide residents and students with access to the internet, free Wi-Fi, and digital literacy programs and other opportunities. We're currently working with Dr. Dewan and her team at the county office to distribute 8,000 high quality hotspots to student households in San Jose. But back to Access Eastside, this project is an innovative approach to respond to community Wi-Fi needs. It demonstrates what's possible when schools and local government and the private sector join forces. So this project, now more than 6 years in the making, tonight's discussion serves as a case study of these opportunities, challenges, and lessons learned relating to tech bonds as a connectivity approach. So I am really pleased to introduce the brains and the technical expertise behind the city side of this, Rajani Nair from the city manager's Civic Innovation Office.
Thank you, Jill. Appreciate that. There's more of the brains that's behind this, but I'll save that towards the end. Can everyone hear me? Okay. So thank you again, Jill and Dr. Dewan, for the opportunity to present to all of you. In this portion of the presentation, I'm going to provide you an overview of the city's main contributions pertaining to Access Eastside, lessons learned, and budget and timeline and next steps. So just starting off with the scope of work that was associated with James Lick, Overfelt, and Erba Buena, The main thing was to provide free outdoor Wi-Fi, provide the community also with LTE hotspots through a partnership that Eastside Union had with Sprint. Also provide community Wi-Fi access to a total of 5,100 students, in addition to non-student households. And the estimate that we have learned is approximately 18,000 households, which is fantastic. This innovative partnership between the city and Eastside Union is basically where the district provides the funding to support the design, implementation, and the maintenance, while the city provides the city assets, so the streetlights and the fiber, to support the network service and focus on the implementation through a contractual service that we had with the network solution provider that Randy mentioned, SmartWave. To date, this is the largest known public sector intervention in digital inclusion. Next slide, please. So what I meant by being the largest, it literally took a village to make this project a great success. And in addition to the partnership with Eastside Union and the city, we partnered with SmartWave, who focused on the design for the community Wi-Fi and also coordinated with PG&E electrical contractors such as Rosedon, Bear Electrical Solutions, and Cupertino Electric. Also, we worked closely with Silicon Valley Talent Partnership and PayPal to help us with the technical assessment on the usage and reliability at James Lick. And that was some of the data that Randy shared earlier in his presentation. So kind of digging deeper about the amount of data that was transferred, he mentioned about 5 terabytes. Just for reference, for those of you who may not correlate what that is, that's half the data of what the Hubble telescope collects in 1 year, or half the data of all the printed documents that's in our Library of Congress, just for reference. And also, the reliability is what we learned through this technical assessment to be 99.4. Next slide, please. So with this being our very first public partnership with Eastside and working on some new innovative technology that Jill mentioned, there was a lot of lessons learned, and these were very important for us because we knew that there were multiple phases that were going to happen afterwards. So some of the things that we learned was that we just had limited record drawings, and what that is just showing the existing infrastructure of how things were built. And particularly in areas where it was annexed with the county or built prior to the 1970s, we really just didn't have good information. Also, we really didn't have a good understanding of the ownership of poles. Just for reference, I mean, the city of San Jose owns 67,000 streetlights, and that does not include what the county owns or what PG&E owns throughout San Jose. So, not having a really good understanding of that, nor having a good database to really understand that was essential. Particularly in the area of James Lick, a lot of the streetlights were used wooden poles. And many of that, we just never really upgraded that to meet the current electrical standards. So there was a lot of extra costs that we didn't anticipate when deploying this project. Next slide, please. So I wanted to just share just the breakdown, because we've shared earlier that it was roughly about 1.4 in what Randy said for the capital costs, but then there's also additional operations and maintenance costs, which is about 200 in a 5-year span. I wanted to just share with all of you just how that breakdown of the cost is distributed in 4 phases of work. Again, just wanted to emphasize this is for 200 streetlights, and as Randy also mentioned, to seek the coverage of about 75% within an attendance area. So the first phase was with the network planning. And this is where, when we worked with SmartWave, who was our network consultant, Just really wanted to better understand what are the poles that need to be used in order to ensure that we have good coverage to meet the minimum criteria that Eastside Union wanted us to cover. And then if there's any additional records that the city can provide, you know, we'll give that to the network solution provider. The next phase of work was with the design and the permitting. This part is where we worked very closely with SmartWave, who, again, the selected network provider, to, you know, go into detail and really get into more of the electrical and structural requirements to make sure that things were installed safe and, you know, met electrical codes. The third phase is the installation, where this is where more than 50% of the budget goes towards, is covering the cost of purchasing the equipment and also the labor, the construction portion of the work, where this is specialty work. So this requires electrical contractors to install that are certified. And the last one is the ongoing operations and maintenance funding. And this is just showing what an annual cost would be. But at, the way that the partnership between Eastside Union and the city, this is going to be covered over a span of every 5 years. Next slide, please. And I've been listening to a lot of the comments from the public, and appreciate greatly everyone's passion and interest to get this done. We surely believe in that too. But I did want to at least share just some of the steps that the city is obligated to do in how to ensure that we can deliver these projects and try to do it as fast as we can. Just wanted to clarify what we were able to do for James Lick, Overfelt, and Herbabuena. We were able to leverage an existing procurement that allowed us to expedite it as fast as we can. Unfortunately, that has expired. And so we need to do a new procurement. And so it does take some time. This is especially the next phases of work. Some of those require federal funding, and there's different mandates that are required. So this duration of about 3 to 4 months is estimated as to how much it takes for us to develop the procurement documents, ensure that legal reviews it, and our procurement team is okay with it. The next part of this time milestone is that some of these contracts require or maybe $1 million. And so as part of the city's policy, we need to seek council approval in order to award the contract. So that is an estimated time of 1 to 2 months. Granted, we're in emergency, so there might be some flexibilities to reduce that time. The next four stages is when we onboard the consultant and, you know, get a contractor on board. That's the next few months that we'll spend, which is a good bulk of the time. So overall, the project delivery could range between 14 to 18 months because we have this new procurement. Next slide, please. So I just wanted to share to the audience, you know, what's our timeline to deliver all this. So as I mentioned before with Herbabuena, we are currently leveraging the procurement that's now expired. But we got council approval on June 30th. So thank you for all San Jose electeds for approving. And so we are on track, and we will complete this work by the end of this year. Next slide, please. So the next two attendance areas that we're going to pursue is the Independence and Oak Grove attendance areas. The city was able to was awarded also on I think on July 1st they were approved the use of community development block grants. Which is about $2 million was given to help support fund this project. And that's a federal fund that's out of the HUD program. Also, the city was able to provide matching funds to help support so that we could have enough funding to deliver the two projects. And then this one, we're currently in process of advertising the procurement for this to seek a new consultant. Next slide, please. So, and this one is for Andrew P. Hill. The city did obtain funding for these, for this project, full funding for the capital costs, and Eastside Union and the city will work together to cover the ongoing maintenance for this. So again, these schedules are still in flux until we onboard a new consultant, and then we can assess their capacity and able to speed up the process. Next slide, please. And so just an overview, combining all of the various projects that are in flight, just wanted to share just an overview of how these projects are all working together. So they are utilizing similar resources. So that's part of the challenges that, we're faced with. And then also just making sure that we have enough vendors, to help us with the design portion, the network consultant or electrical contractors who can help us with building out as fast as possible. So we're looking at all these alternatives. Next slides, please. So how you can help, really spreading the word as much as possible. If you have any network solution providers in your districts that are familiar with this kind of deployment, we really do support that. We have to go through a competitive process. So if those of you who are not familiar, to obtain any of these bid opportunities, you can go through our finance department or through our public works department. But the procurement vendor that we utilize is Bidingo. So that's how they pronounce it. So you can find out these bids. And towards the end of the presentation, I have my contact information if you need more. Next slide, please. Another thing that would be really helpful is really educating the public about all these devices that are attached to streetlights, because they're providing a service, whether it's through the community Wi-Fi or, for a network provider. And so just ensuring that, that these are protected, that they're not damaged, and because it will disrupt service, and then also additional costs to repair it. So this photo just is an example of what it really is important to ensure that the community knows about these services that are being provided. And next slide, please. And last but not least, as I mentioned before, it really took a village to build this community Wi-Fi network. Just take a moment to acknowledge just all the great partners who've been involved in this and supportive in making this happen. So just want a huge shout out to them. And then next slide, please. And if you have additional questions, obviously you can connect with Dr. Dewan, but also here's my contact information if you have anything additional that you would like to ask. And this concludes my presentation, and I'll pass it back to Jill.
Thanks, Regine. I think our overall message is that we at the city have learned through patience and partnership with Eastside Union how to deliver these kinds of projects. And as was discussed in our city council meetings, if other districts are interested in pursuing a solution of this nature or other district-led solutions to digital connectedness, we would love to talk with you early and often and find out how we can work together or support you. I think I'll turn it back to.
Yes. Thank you so much.
We have a polling question.
We do, yes. Our next slide is a polling question, and it's it was a beautiful lead-in from Jill. And I just want to give a shout out to Jill Bourne as a great partner and thought leader in this work. The collaboration is pretty powerful. So are any of our districts considering a tech bond? It looks like a few of our districts are, and a couple are maybes. And so we would just offer that if you are interested and you're within the city of San Jose, we again would really like to help facilitate and get some of the planning and conversations going. Additionally, if you're outside the city of San Jose, we could also provide some support to help other cities consider models similar to the Access East Side model. So we'll go ahead and close the polling here. I'm looking at our Q&A. We're at our next section of Q&A. And again, I don't see any questions. I think our presenters have done a very thorough job and we're not generating many questions this evening. So moving on, so our next steps to advocacy, action, announcements, and some gratitudes. So I wanted to ask Jill to share some of the next steps with our partnership with the City of San Jose.
Yeah, thank you. Make sure I'm still on, yeah. The city's digital inclusion plan also funded the enhancement of outdoor Wi-Fi capabilities at civic facilities, including branch libraries in high needs areas. And we utilize the priority index that you, Dr. Duan, noted earlier, while providing social distancing and promoting public health in those spaces. So these expanded Wi-Fi areas will include outdoor plazas and adjacent areas, including parking lots, providing community members with an additional option to safely connect to higher internet speeds, and for the city to have space to provide services and technology access to residents in a socially distanced way. This will enable our residents to access materials for education, language, citizenship programming, business development, or job seeking programming, among many other services that are necessary for self-sufficiency and personal advancement. So we're really excited to be able to provide this element as well, and it is scheduled to be completed by the end of the calendar year.
So we also wanted to remind everyone of our partnership with the Silicon Valley Community Foundation. We established an education partnership that is designed to help schools in particular address some of the impact of COVID-19, including supports for digital access and inclusion. Information is provided here, and this fund is still also currently accepting donations. Additionally, next slide, please. This is the information if someone is interested in donating to education and also to designate some of those funds for digital inclusion. The next slide shares some additional funding opportunities through the Silicon Valley Community Foundation that also create opportunity to support solutions to the impacts of COVID-19, including the need for digital access and inclusion. The COVID-19 Child Care Project is one, the Regional Response Fund is another, and the Regional Nonprofit Emergency Fund also supports charter schools. Next slide. The City of San Jose has been supporting a number of device donation days hosted by council members. There is a device drive tomorrow, Thursday, July 30th from 4 to 6 at the Calabasas Branch Library. And we'd appreciate some support in getting the word out about this opportunity to donate devices that will get a new life, and partners at Tech Exchange will refurbish those devices. Those that are usable for schools can be supported that way, and those that are not usable for schools can also be shared with families, community, and others. Next slide. Our office recently launched our Digital Equity Closing the Digital Divide webpage, where we are providing information and resources This is one of the places where we include information about the affordable internet offers that are available. And this gives me an opportunity to thank our internet service providers who have partnered with us in a number of ways to provide affordable or low-cost offers, as well as assisting us in getting the word out and supporting families to get them connected. Next slide. I want to close this evening with some thank yous. I want to thank the Silicon Valley Education Foundation for their partnership. Early during the pandemic, they assisted us in getting the word out about the internet service provider offers and many other supports for families. The community-based organizations, including those that are funded by the Digital Inclusion Partnership, have provided much needed supports and access to families. I mentioned already the Silicon Valley Community Foundation, who stepped up immediately to also support this work. First Five Santa Clara County, led by Jolene Smith, has been an avid supporter of closing the digital divide. The Digital Equity Coalition of school board members have been amazing partners in this work as well, and really helped raise awareness about all the aspects of the lack of access to the internet and the negative impact it was having on children and families. I'd like to thank CETF for their partnership in assisting us with not just device distributions within the city of San Jose, but in other parts of the county as well. And Supervisor Cindy Chavez for her support and also helping to raise awareness and make connections for all of us. And Supervisor Ellenberg, who is partnering with the County Office of Education to look at some micro infrastructure solutions. And we're very excited to be investing in that partnership as well. I'd like to thank Mayor Sam Liccardo, the City Council members, Supervisor Cortese, our County Board of Supervisors, the County Board of Education, Jill Bourne, and Randy Phelps. And we'd like to thank our school communities for their creativity, passion, teamwork, and patience to adapt to this pandemic. And to all of the attendees who joined us, thank you for your participation and your contributions. We do intend to have one additional forum in this series, and we'll get the word out soon about when that will be and the topic that we'll be covering. Have a good evening.